In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night, in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters scattered throughout the world, come together to watch and pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal solemnity in this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, then we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death and living with him in God. Let us pray. O God, who through your Son bestowed upon the faithful the fire of your glory, sanctify this new fire, we pray, and grant that by these Paschal celebrations we may be so inflamed with heavenly desires that with minds made pure we may attain festivities of unending splendor through Christ our Lord. Amen. Christ, yesterday and today, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, all time belongs to him. And all the ages. To him be glory and power through every age, forever and ever. Amen. By his holy and glorious wounds, may Christ the Lord guard us and protect us. Amen. May the light of Christ rising in glory dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds.
Lumen Christi.
Lumen Christi.
Exalt, let them exalt the hosts of heaven. Exalt, let angel ministers of God exalt. Let the trumpet of salvation sound aloud our mighty King's triumph. Be glad, let earth be glad, as glory floods her, ablaze with light from her eternal King. Let all corners of the earth be glad, knowing an end to gloom and darkness. Rejoice, let Mother Church also rejoice, arrayed with the lightning of his glory. Let this holy building shake with joy, filled with the mighty voices of the peoples. Therefore, dearest friends, standing in the awesome glory of this holy light, invoke with me, I ask you, the mercy of God Almighty, that he who has been pleased to number me, though unworthy, among the Levites, may pour into me his light unshadowed, that I may sing this candle's perfect praises. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, with ardent love of mind and heart, and with devoted service of our voice, to acclaim our God invisible, the Almighty Father, and Jesus Christ our Lord, his Son, his only begotten, who for our sake paid Adam's debt to the eternal Father, and pouring out his own dear blood, wiped clean the record of our ancient sinfulness. These are the feast of Passover, in which is slain the Lamb, the one true Lamb, whose blood anoints the doorposts of believers. This is the night when once you led our forebears, Israel's children, from slavery in Egypt, and made them pass dry through the sea. This is the night that with a pillar of fire banished the darkness of sin. This is the night that even now throughout the world sets Christian believers apart from worldly vices and from the gloom of sin, leading them to grace and joining them to his holy ones. This is the night when Christ broke the prison bars of death and rose victorious from the underworld. Our birth would have been no gain had we not been redeemed. O wonder of your humble care for us, O love of charity beyond all telling, to ransom a slave, you gave away your Son. O truly necessary sin of Adam, destroyed completely by the death of Christ. O happy fault that earned so great, so glorious a Redeemer. O truly blessed night, worthy alone to know the time and hour when Christ rose from the underworld. This is the night of which it is written, the night shall be as bright as day. Dazzling is the night for me and full of gladness. The sanctifying power of this night dispels all wickedness, washes faults away, restores innocence to the fallen, and joy to mourners, drives out hatred, fosters concord, and brings down the mighty. On this your night of grace, O Holy Father, accept this candle, a solemn offering, the work of these in your servants' hands, an evening sacrifice of praise, this gift from your most holy church. But now we know the praises of this pillar, which glowing fire ignites for God's honor. A fire into many flames divided, yet never dimmed by sharing of its light. For it is fed by melting wax, drawn out by mother bees, to build a torch so precious. Oh, truly blessed night, when things of heaven are wed to those of earth, and divine to the human. Therefore, O Lord, we pray you that this candle, hallowed to the honor of your name, may persevere undimmed to overcome the darkness of this night. Receive it as a pleasing fragrance, and let it mingle with the lights of heaven. May this flame be found still burning by the morning star, the one morning star who never sets, Christ your Son, who coming back from death's domain has shed his peaceful light on humanity and lives and reigns forever and ever.
Dear brothers and sisters, now that we have begun our solemn vigil, let us listen with quiet hearts to the Word of God. Let us meditate on how God in times past saved his people, and in these, the last days, has sent his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this paschal work of salvation by the fullness of redemption.
Please extinguish.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss, while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. God saw how good the light was. Then God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Thus evening came, and morning followed, the first day. Then God said, "Let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other." And so it happened. God made the dome, and it separated the water above the dome from the water below it. God called the dome the sky. Evening came, and morning followed, the second day. Then God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered into a single basin, so that the dry land may appear." And so it happened. The water under the sky was gathered into its basin, and the dry land appeared. God called the dry land the earth, and the basin of water he called the sea. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth vegetation, every kind of plant that bears seeds, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it." And so it happened. The earth brought forth every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seeds in it. God saw how good it was. Evening came, and morning followed, the third day. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate day from night. Let them mark the fixed times, the days and the years, and serve as luminaries in the dome of the sky, and shed light upon the earth." And so it happened. God made the two great lights, the greater one to govern the day, and the lesser one to govern the night. And he made the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. God saw how good it was. Evening came, and morning followed, the fourth day. Then God said, "Let the water teem with an abundance of living creatures, and on the earth let birds fly beneath the dome of the sky." And so it happened. God created the great sea monsters and all kinds of swimming creatures with which the water teems, and all kinds of winged birds. God saw how good it was, and God blessed them, saying, "Be fertile, multiply, and fill the water of the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." Evening came, and morning followed, the fifth day. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth all kinds of living creatures, cattle, creeping things, and wild animals of all kinds." And so it happened. God made all kinds of wild animals, all kinds of cattle, and all kinds of creeping things of the earth. God saw how good it was. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and the cattle, and over all the wild animals, and all the creatures that crawl on the ground. God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, saying, "Be fertile and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all the living things that move on the earth." God also said, "See, I give you every seed-bearing plant all over the earth, and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it to be your food. And to all the animals of the land, all the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that crawl on the ground, I give all the green plants for food." And so it happened. God looked on everything that he had made, and he found it very good. Evening came, and morning followed, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth and all their array were completed. Since on the seventh day God was finished with the work he had been doing, he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had undertaken. The word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who are wonderful in ordering all your works, may those you have redeemed understand that there exists nothing more marvelous than the world's creation in the beginning, except that at the end of the ages, Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward, and you lift up your staff, and with your hand outstretched over the sea, split the sea in two, that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory through Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I receive glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers." The angel of God, who had been leading Israel's group, now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them. And so it came between the camp of the Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed without the rival camps coming any closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hands over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so turned it into dry land. When the water was thus divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like a wall on their right and to their left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All Pharaoh's horses and chariots and charioteers went after them right into the midst of the sea. In the night watch, just before dawn, the Lord cast through the column of the fiery cloud upon the Egyptian force a glance that threw it into a panic, and he so clogged their chariot wheels that they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians. Then the Lord told Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and charioteers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn, the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing headlong toward the sea, when the Lord hurled them into its midst. As the water flowed back, it covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land through the midst of the sea, with the water like a wall on their right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day from the power of the Egyptians. When Israel saw the Egyptians lying on the seashore, and behind the great power and beheld the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians. They feared the Lord and believed in him and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord, for he is gloriously triumphant. Horse and chariot he has cast into the sea. The word of the Lord.
Let us pray. O God, whose ancient wonders remain undimmed in splendor even in our day, for what you once bestowed on a single people, fleeing then from Pharaoh's persecution by the power of your right hand, now you bring about as the salvation of the nations through the waters of rebirth. Grant, we pray, that the whole world may become children of Abraham and inherit the dignity of Israel's birthright. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come without paying and without cost. Drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully. Listen, that you may have life. I will renew with you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David. As I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander of nations, so shall you summon a nation you knew not. And nations that knew you not shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his ways, and the wicked man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God, who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and your thoughts above your thoughts. For just as from the heavens the rain and the snow come down and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word that comes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sole hope of the world, who by the preaching of your prophets unveiled the mysteries of this present age, graciously increase the longing of your people, for only at the prompting of your grace do the faithful progress in any kind of virtue. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Sacred night radiant with the glory of the Lord's resurrection. Stir up in your church a spirit of adoption, so that renewed in body and mind, we may render you undivided service. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
Trích thư Thánh Phaolô Tông Đồ gửi tín hữu Roma. Anh em thân mến, tất cả chúng ta đã chịu phép rửa trong Đức Giêsu Kitô, tức là đã chịu phép rửa trong sự chết của Người, và chúng ta đã cùng chịu mai táng với Người. Bởi được thanh tẩy trong sự chết của Người, để như Đức Kitô nhờ vinh hiển của Chúa Cha mà sống lại từ cõi chết thế nào, thì cả chúng ta cũng phải sống đời sống mới như thế. Vì nếu chúng ta được liên kết với Người trong cùng một cái chết, giống như cái chết của Người, thì chúng ta cũng được hợp nhất với Người trong sự sống lại giống như vậy. Nên biết điều này, con người cũ của chúng ta đã cùng chịu đóng đinh khổ giá, để xác thịt tội lỗi bị hủy đi, hầu cho chúng ta không còn làm nô lệ tội lỗi nữa. Vì con người đã chết, tức là được giải thoát khỏi tội lỗi. Mà nếu chúng ta đã chết với Đức Kitô, chúng ta tin rằng chúng ta cũng sẽ cùng sống với Người. Vì biết rằng Đức Kitô một khi từ cõi chết sống lại, Người không chết nữa. Sự chết không còn làm chủ được Người nữa. Người đã chết, tức là chết một lần dứt khoát đối với tội lỗi. Mà khi Người sống, là sống cho Thiên Chúa. Cả anh em cũng thế. Anh em hãy tự kể như mình đã chết đối với tội lỗi, nhưng sống cho Thiên Chúa trong Đức Giêsu Kitô Chúa chúng ta. Đó là lời Chúa.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Thank you.
Gospel according to Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. Very early, when the sun had risen, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb. They were saying to one another, "Who will roll back the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. On entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a white robe, and they were utterly amazed. He said to them, "Do not be amazed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, the crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him, but go and tell his disciples and Peter, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him as he told you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Holy Saturday is one of my very favorite days of the liturgical year. For many, many years, more often than not, on Holy Saturday I make time to visit a cemetery, as I did this morning. I live right next to Resurrection Cemetery, Catholic Pastoral Center. Walking through the cemetery and reflecting upon the mystery of the Lord's passion and death, which we celebrated yesterday, and the mysterious silence that overcomes the world, very evident in a cemetery. Awaiting in hope the Alleluias announcing the Lord's resurrection. On this holy night, I'm delighted to welcome each and every one of you here this evening to Our Lady's Cathedral for this solemn Easter Vigil Mass, along with Father Stansberry and Father Tang, our deacons. Happy to welcome all of you, parishioners, friends, to this first Easter liturgy, but especially to welcome you, to acknowledge the presence of you who are about to be initiated into the church through baptism, through profession of faith, through confirmation, through the Eucharist. In many ways, the church's celebration this evening is really geared toward the mystery and the celebration of initiation, the mystery of baptism and the sacraments. We're glad that you are here, along with all of those who have come to join us on this most solemn and holy night. It's great drama the sacred events which the Church recalls during these days of the Paschal Triduum. For the disciples and the scoffers alike, who personally witnessed the shocking events of Good Friday, it seemed as if all of the great hopes which so many had placed in Jesus had come in the end to nothing. With his betrayal, his arrest, the hands of his own disciples, his condemnation to a shameful death, it certainly appeared that Jesus' life and mission had been a disappointing and colossal failure. Sometimes our lives, too, are marked by similar profound disappointments, failures, and perhaps tonight we are all too well aware of some of our own betrayals and shortcomings in life. But God's plan for Jesus and for us did not and does not end with the humiliation of Good Friday. A number of years ago, St. John Paul II bore witness to our Easter hope when he said, "We are not the sum of our failures. We are the sum of the Father's love for us, and our real capacity is to become the image of his Son, Jesus." Tonight, the Easter proclamation, which Father Rick chanted to begin this solemn celebration, the Exultet, announces the good news that Jesus Christ is victorious over sin, over despair, over death. He has conquered death. He has broken death's iron grip. He has restored us to life and to freedom. The world is set free from Satan's dominion, which had held us captive to sin and hopelessness through fear of death. The good news, the gospel, which we proclaim tonight, is that Christ has despoiled death once and for all through his dying, through his descent into hell, and his rising to new life. There's a beautiful ancient homily for Holy Saturday, which is part of the Church's Liturgy of the Hours for this day, Holy Saturday. The writer reflects on the mysterious silence that I referred to earlier, which hangs over the world between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. This homily is really a meditation on what we mean when we say in the Creed, as we do every Sunday and solemnity, "He descended into hell." What does that mean? Christ has fallen asleep in the flesh, and now all who have ever lived and died await the outcome of a hidden contest with cosmic and eternal consequences. Human experience teaches us and bears witness to the fact that death greedily devours all living things and spares none. But in his pride, Satan, who arrogantly drags Jesus into his stronghold in hell, in the underworld, at his death, gets more than he bargained for. The homilist of that early sermon says, God has died in the flesh, and hell trembles with fear. We suggest an analogy. In the classical world, the Greek world, ancient poets tell how the Greeks finally gained victory in the long Trojan War and rescued the beautiful Helen, who is being held within the fortified city of Troy. They had fought for years. And victory finally came when the Greeks tricked their enemies into allowing them into the city to break the siege, to seize them by building what's known as the Trojan Horse. Perhaps you've heard the story. And leaving it as a gift at the city gates. But unbeknownst to the Trojans in the city, the horse contained a band of picked soldiers who they themselves unwittingly brought into the city and who ultimately brought about its downfall. It seems a fairly good analogy for the mystery of our Lord's descent into hell after his death on the cross. By allowing himself to be crucified, by submitting to death, Jesus entered triumphantly into the realm of the dead to destroy the stronghold of Satan and to set free all who had been held captive there. Jesus is willing to enter into the dark realms of sin in our hearts and to free us from bondage as well. It is only up to us to open the gates and let him in. Death is powerless against the Lord of life. Being without sin, corruption could not sink its teeth into Jesus' mortal flesh. Hell could not contain him. Rising victorious from death to life, Jesus brings in his wake all of the just who lived before him and awaited his coming in hope. By dying, he destroys the power of death, and by rising from the dead, he restores us to new and everlasting life. On this holy night, this Easter vigil, we proclaim this victory. Christ is risen. He has conquered death. But it is not only Jesus' victory, it is our victory. Because after all, we are not merely the sum of our failures. We have come to share in this victory through the mystery of our baptism, the mystery of baptism that we will celebrate for the elect in just a few moments. As St. Paul says, we were buried with him through baptism into his death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. This newness of life, this hope of resurrection, is not some distant dream. Though we believe that our mortal bodies, which will die, will also one day be glorified and raised up with Jesus on the last day, we believe, and we know because our faith teaches us, that we live this new life today already through our baptism. Through faith and through baptism, we are joined to Christ by the power of his Spirit, so that through prayer and through the sacraments, we can live this new life in the Spirit and grow daily into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ as we experience sanctification and transformation, as we grow in holiness and prepare ourselves for the resurrection of the dead. We are children of God. We are beloved daughters and we are beloved son, beloved of our Heavenly Father. We have been claimed by Christ. We have been redeemed by his blood. We belong to him. This is our Easter faith. This is what we celebrate tonight. His victory, our victory, through baptism, strengthened in the sacraments, especially in the sacrament of the Eucharist and confirmation. And so as we continue this sacred liturgy this evening, we move to the celebration of baptism for the elect, confirmation, and the renewal of our baptismal promises as we prepare to come forward to receive the body and blood of Jesus, glorified and risen from the dead. With one heart and one soul, let us by our prayers come to the aid of these, our brothers and sisters, in their blessed hope, so that as they approach the font of rebirth, the Almighty Father may bestow on them all his merciful help.
Oh.
Almighty ever living God, be present by the mysteries of your great love and send forth the spirit of adoption to create the new peoples brought to birth for you in the font of baptism, so that what is to be carried out by our humble service may be brought to fulfillment by your mighty power through Christ our Lord. O God, who by invisible power accomplish a wonderful effect through sacramental signs, and who in many ways have poured water, your creation, to show forth the grace of baptism. O God, whose spirit, in the first moments of the world's creation, hovered over the waters so that the very substance of water would even then take to itself the power to sanctify. O God, who by the outpouring of the flood foreshadowed the regeneration, so that from the mystery of one and the same element of water would come an end to vice and the beginning of virtue. O God, who caused the children of Abraham to pass dry shod through the Red Sea, so that the chosen people set free from slavery to Pharaoh would prefigure the people of the baptized. O God, whose Son, baptized by John in the waters of the Jordan, was anointed with the Holy Spirit, and as he hung upon the cross, gave forth water from his side along with blood, and after his resurrection, commanded his disciples, "Go forth, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Look now, we pray, upon the face of your church and graciously unseal for her the fountain of baptism. May this water receive by the Holy Spirit the grace of your only begotten Son, so that human nature created in your image and washed clean through the sacrament of baptism from all the squalor of the life of old may be found worthy to rise to the life of newborn children through water and the Holy Spirit." May the power of the Holy Spirit, O Lord, we pray, come down through your Son into the fullness of this font, so that all who have been buried with Christ by baptism into death may rise again to life with him who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Father, you have called your children to this cleansing water that they may share in the faith of your church. By the mystery of this consecrated water, lead them to a new and spiritual birth. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And so I ask you, those who are to be baptized and received into the church, do you renounce sin so as to live in the freedom of the children of God? Do you renounce the lure of evil so that sin may have no mastery over you? Do you renounce Satan, the author and prince of sin? Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? This is our faith. This is the faith of the Church. We are proud to profess it in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Anthony, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
You have become a new creation and have clothed yourselves in Christ. Receive this baptismal garment and bring it unstained to the judgment seat of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that you may have everlasting life. Amen. You have been enlightened by Christ. Walk always as children of the light, and keep the flame of faith alive in your hearts. When the Lord comes, may you go out to meet him with all the saints in the heavenly kingdom. Amen. Brothers and sisters, by your own free will, you have asked to be received into the full communion of the Catholic Church. You have made your decision after careful thought and under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. I now invite you to come forward with your sponsors and in the presence of this community to profess the Catholic faith. In this faith, you will be one with us for the first time at the Eucharistic table of the Lord Jesus, the sign of the Church's unity. And so I ask you, do you believe and profess all that the Holy Catholic Church believes, teaches, and proclaims to be revealed by God? The Lord receives you into the Catholic Church. His loving kindness has led you here, so that in the unity of the Holy Spirit, you may have full communion with us in the faith you have professed in the presence of his family.
Amen.
My dear candidates for confirmation, by your baptism, you have been reborn in Christ. And you have become members of Christ and of his priestly people. Now you are to share in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit among us, the Spirit sent by the Lord upon his apostles at Pentecost and given by them and their successors to the baptized. The promised strength of the Holy Spirit, which you are to receive, will make you more like Christ and help you be witnesses to his suffering, death, and resurrection. It will strengthen you to be active members of the Church, and so build up the body of Christ in faith and love. Dearly beloved, let us pray to the Almighty Father for these his adopted sons and daughters, already born again to eternal life in baptism, that he will graciously pour out the Holy Spirit upon them to confirm them with his abundant gifts, and through his anointing, conform them more fully to Christ, the Son of God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who brought these your servants to new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, freeing them from sin. Send upon them, O Lord, the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Give them the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and fortitude, the spirit of knowledge and piety. Fill them with the spirit of the fear of the Lord, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
My dear brothers and sisters, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism by which we once renounced Satan and his works and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce sin so as to live in the freedom of the children of God? Do you renounce the lure of evil so that sin may have no mastery over you? Do you renounce Satan, the author and prince of sin? Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?
Do
you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I do.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting?
I do.
And may Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins, keep us by his grace in Christ Jesus our Lord for eternal life. Amen.
Here's one out.
Thank you.
On this holy night, when Jesus Christ rose from the dead and restored our life of grace, we turn to God our Father in prayer, asking for all our needs.
That through our suffering, the life of the Lord, this Easter may be a new beginning in our journey. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those baptized are receiving to full communion with the church tonight, that they may continue to grow in faith and love of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that the peace of the risen Christ heals the wounds of violence, hatred, and injustice, and may peace and justice flourish in our world, in our homes, and in our hearts. At this time, we pray particularly for peace in Ukraine and Holy Land. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of every nation, may come to share the joy of this night. May the good news of resurrection of Christ be gladdening the hearts of all people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all whose lifelong vigil for the Lord has ended, and who now sleep in peace, may they live forever in Christ, who has destroyed the power of death and open the gates of heavenly kingdom to all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We bow our heads and remember in silence our own personal intention and the intention of those who have asked for our prayers. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God our Father, as we celebrate the resurrection of Christ, your Son, we ask you to strengthen us in faith, that we may proclaim the pardon and peace you have given us. We make this prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, we ask, O Lord, the prayers of your people with the sacrificial offerings, that what has begun in the Paschal mysteries may, by the work of your power, bring us to the healing of eternity. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this night above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true.
Celebrating the most sacred night of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude,
Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmos and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you, also for those whom you have been pleased to give the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, granting them forgiveness of all their sins. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, so that in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servant, who have gone before us with the signs of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. We await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word.
Let us pray. Pour out on us, O Lord, the spirit of your love, and in your kindness, make those you have nourished by this Paschal sacrament one in mind and heart, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Just a few announcements. Again, thank all of you for being here, and a blessed happy Easter to all of you. Tomorrow, we will be having an Easter egg hunt hosted by our TNTT youth group, and that will be after the 10 o'clock Mass and after the 11:45 Mass. Marriage in His Image, which is our program, Marriage Enrichment for Married Couples of All Ages, will meet next Saturday, April 6th at 6:30. We will be honoring our high school seniors next Sunday, April 7th, during the 10 o'clock Mass. And the Knights of Columbus will be holding a pancake breakfast in the Connor Center next Sunday from 9 till 12. And Divine Mercy Sunday is next Sunday, April 7th, a lot going on next Sunday. We will have the Chaplet of Divine Mercy at 3 p.m. in English and then at 5 p.m. in Vietnamese. And first of all, I would just like to say on behalf of all of us, a big thank you to all who've worked so hard to make our liturgies so beautiful this week. To our wonderful altar servers, the ushers, the lectors, the people, our the deacons, but a big special word of thanks to our wonderful choir under the direction of Mr. Nolan Riley. They have been here Palm Sunday, Chrism Mass, Holy Thursday, Good Friday, this Mass, and two more tomorrow. So thank you for truly making a joyful sound to the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for a blessing.
May Almighty God bless you through today's Easter solemnity and in his compassion defend you from every assault of sin.
Amen. Amen.
May he who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of his only begotten Son endow you with the prize of immortality.
Amen.
Now that the days of the Lord's Passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate the gladness of the Paschal Feast come with Christ's help and exulting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Go in peace. Alleluia.